We're changing our brain and body to live in that future present reality so that you feel connected to a future instead of the past. And when you're connected to the past, you're looking for it. And if you're looking for it, you're separate from it. The majority of our thoughts and feelings are connected to our sexuality, to our victimization, our guilt, our suffering, our shame, our unworthiness, our self-doubt.
I've watched people who, you know, this person's caused this insecurity in their life. And even when they remove the person, what they'll do is, okay, now I'm going to feel gratitude, what you just said. But they're sort of, their body is still addicted to that emotion, and they go seek other references to get them that emotion again. So the first thing you said that I love, that I've not heard before, is one, is acknowledge when that addiction rears its head again, just by acknowledging it. The second thing that really nobody talks about is, it's wonderful to meditate and to get into that space, but then you must get up and be active towards that goal. That's what most people don't ever talk about.
We're changing our brain and body to live in that future present reality so that you feel connected to a future instead of the past. Well, and when you're connected to the past, you're looking for it. And if you're looking for it, you're separate from it. If you're being it, then there's a complete change in energy, and nobody changes until they change their energy. And when you change your energy, you change your life. After 8,500 brain scans, I can tell you that you and I are at our absolute best when we get beyond ourselves. That is the elegant moment where we're free enough to create without any encumbrances.
So this has been measured too. So there's these different energy centers in the body. Is it true that if you're holding on to these other emotions, I just want a basic answer for this for the group too. If you're holding on to these negative emotions and you're not moving towards this more empowering emotion, what happens to these energy centers in the body? Can you describe that to some extent?
The majority of our thoughts and feelings are connected to our sexuality, to our victimization, our guilt, our suffering, our shame, our unworthiness, our self-doubt, or our importance, our control, our fear, our anger, our frustration, our hatred, our judgment. Those are the first three hormonal centers in the body. And those first three centers have everything to do with survival. And those centers are energy consumers. Orgasm, digestion, stress is a lot of energy that we're drawing from our very vital life force, our resource of light and information, and we're turning it into chemistry. And we're literally robbing the body's energy, right? So then living like that for the short term is okay, because the body can move back to homeostasis and can restore itself. But when we're overdoing that consistently, then there's no energy for growth and repair, because you're living constantly in survival. So again, you can eat all the right food, you can do all the right things, but if you're living in anxiety and fear, and you're viewing your world from the worst case scenario that could possibly happen, because that's what you do in survival, there's no energy for growth and repair. There's no energy for healing. So the majority of our thoughts are signaling certain circuits in the brain that signal another part of the brain, the limbic brain, to make what's called a neuropeptide. Neuropeptides are chemical messengers that signal hormonal centers. So now you're taking thought and you're storing it as energy in these energy centers. And if you're living in survival, why would you open your heart? I mean, it's just not a time to open your heart. I mean, if you're getting chased by T-Rex, it's not a time to meditate. It's not a time to learn. It's not a time to connect. It's not a time to communicate. It's not a time to sit down and go within. It's not a time to be vulnerable. It's time to run, fight, or hide. And so,
is that why we're this way? I've never asked you this before. Is this some? I don't think you believe this, but I just want to understand this. Is this some sort of genetic disposition that's been passed down to us since we've been chased by T-Rex?
I think so. I think survival has been very adaptive.
Yeah.
Like, because if you're being chased by T-Rex, you don't run up to T-Rex and say, oh, cute little dinosaur, let me pet you. That's not adaptive. The fear is adaptive. You run from the unknown. You run from challenges, right?
Yes.
So if you're living in survival, there's better chances of surviving if you run from the unknown. And by the way, when you're living in survival, at the infinite potentials in the quantum field, you'll select the worst case scenario in your mind. And you'll begin to emotionally prepare yourself for the worst case scenario, because you have better chances of surviving.
There you go.
If you prepare for the worst, right?
There you
go. So people spend their whole life thinking about the worst thing and emotionally embracing it. Well, you take a thought and emotion, or an image and an emotion, you're branding or conditioning your body into what? Anxiety, into fear. So then you keep doing that over and over again, over and over again. The body becomes the mind of fear. And whether you think you can control it or not, you're going to have a panic attack. And the panic attack is the body saying, you've conditioned me this way. Try as you may with your conscious mind to control it. You programmed it subconsciously. Then you start worrying about the next panic attack. And it's that very anticipation that keeps the person on the hamster wheel.
And
right?
robs them of all of this energy as well.
Absolutely. So they don't believe impossibility when they're living in that state, because in survival, it's not a time to create. All the blood flow is going to the hind brain and away from the forebrain. There's no physiology really for a person to begin to create a new future. So think about it. So then 70% of the time, people in the world are living anticipating the next moment based on their past moment. And so they're laying reality down moment by moment with the next known, the next predictable moment. And so the hormones of stress endorse the senses. Our senses become heightened when we're under stress, and we become materialists. We narrow our focus on the danger.
Yes.
So then you're focusing on matter. You're focusing on the material world. And when you do that, you put all your attention, the arousal of the stress hormones puts all your attention on your body. If you're being chased by T-Rex, you better be paying attention to your body. When people start reaching this moment, my goodness, they're overcoming themselves. And now they're at that perfect place to create. And my definition of creation is when I forget about myself.
Wow.
That's when you're free. So some people can do it because they've practiced it. Other people can't get beyond the addiction of a certain emotion. That means their body is still their mind.
Yes.
So then if you're sitting in a meditation and your body's throwing the kitchen sink at you and saying, Ed, you're a loser, you're never going to change, this is too hard, why don't you quit? And you're aware that that's your body doing that, and you say to your body, we're going to sit here and we're going to sit in this fire, and I'm going to keep applying the formula, and your brain starts running to all the emails you have to do, and you become aware of that, and you return back to the present moment, and you tell the body it's no longer the mind, that you're the mind. Now your will is getting greater than that program, and there's a liberation of energy. And every time you do that, that's a victory. And you teach people,
every time you do that, that's a victory.
That's
when
a
your
victory.
Mind tells the body, I'm in charge.
When you say to your, when you want to get up and you want to quit, and you go, oh, now that's my body, bring it back.
Okay.
And now you're taming the animal. The body is the animal, and you're like a dog, you sit. And if you keep doing this, you're climbing on top, and the body finally acquiesces. It finally says, I'm not going anywhere. And then boom, there's this liberation of energy. What's the side effect? Joy. Person's heart just automatically opens up, and every time they do that, those victories add up. There's no such thing as a bad meditation. There's only overcoming yourself. And when you sit in the fire and you work with that, people say to me, why do you meditate every morning? I say, because if I can overcome myself in the morning, the rest of my day is easy.
It's
easy.
Not true?
Because that's what it's about. You master yourself. You master your life.
Yes.
And so then all the chatter in your head that you listen to all day long, that is called the default mode network in the brain. Our research shows that shuts off. Not just shuts off during the meditation. It stays shut off for the rest of the day. So the critic in your head that's telling you this will never happen, you don't have enough time, that there's no voice there. So you just have a clear flow on where you're going, and you trust yourself more.
Yes.
So then when you start practicing creating that brain and heart coherence, you can believe in a future that you can't see or experience with your senses yet, but you've thought about enough times in your mind that it's actually, there's physical evidence in your brain to look like it's already happened.
Man.
And you can begin to understand, you can select a new potential in the quantum field and every day emotionally embrace that future reality to such a degree that your body begins to believe it's living in that future reality in the present moment. And you're signaling new genes and new ways to change your body to look like it's already happened. Now think about this. If there's physical evidence by thought alone in your brain and body to look like your wealth or your future has already happened, it's already happened.
Already happened.
And you're already it. So it's not about your wealth. It's not about your health. It's not about your freedom. It's who you become. So then as you overcome, you become someone else.
Hey guys, thanks for sticking around. If you'd like more, click the videos right here. They're exactly what you need to see next. And if you're new here, hit subscribe and become a part of the Max Out community. And tell me what you think about the videos in the comments below. I read all of them every week, and I select winners that get all kinds of prizes, gear, coaching calls with me. Make a comment.